Thank you, Kevin Powers, for joining us today at Google Play to talk about your novel, Yellow Birds.
Thank you for having me.
Tell us a little bit about the book and how you came to write it.
Well, I'm a veteran myself. Mm-hmm. And when I came home, I think this is a really common question, but one of the questions I was asked most frequently is, what was it like over there? Which is sort of a broad question, very difficult to answer. So what I try to do is think of the relationships, the way that people understand things by comparing them to their own experience. Mm-hmm. So I tried to write a story of two friends, something that would be compelling, also make it aesthetically affecting. Mm-hmm. Because I think people sort of have this sense that it's a subject that they can't understand, mm-hmm. or what combat is like, but I actually think that people can understand it. I think empathy is sort of an imaginative act. Everybody knows what it's like to sort of feel fear or anger, shame. So I tried to just tell a story that people could relate to on a small scale. Mm-hmm. I think a lot of people have done really interesting work on kind of the big picture of our involvement in Iraq and Afghanistan. Mm-hmm. I just thought there was an opportunity to take a different approach.
One of the things that really arrested me from the very beginning is the epigraph you use. That's from where the title comes.
Yes.
And the title's so gentle, you know, Yellow Birds. And I didn't know about this epigraph, this army song that takes this image of yellow birds and turns it into something very brutal very quickly. And I thought, wow, this book is just dropping me into an experience right now. And did you think about, is that where it started for you? Was that something that, that epigraph was sort of in your head as sort of the mood for the novel opening?
I wanted to make sure I got the sort of mood and the tone and the voice right, mm-hmm. first when I was thinking about how to sort of introduce the reader to what that tone was going to be like. I thought of that song and how strange it is to somebody who hasn't sort of been in that situation, in that kind of culture, when honestly, violence is something that you experience on a regular basis, and it can kind of lead to black humor,
right,
and that sort of
right.
thing. So it just seemed like the perfect way to sort of signal what the book might be like, and that, you know, the first thing you see may not be actually how it immediately appears, and
right.
be something entirely different. So
it was very effective.
Well,
it certainly set the stage for me, and I thought
glad.
It was it was very well chosen. So tell us a little bit about Bartle and Murph, the two characters that you're really focusing on here.
Well, you know, so Bartle is the narrator of the mm-hmm. novel, and he becomes responsible for, in his own mind anyway, the welfare of his friend, Murph, who is much younger, mm-hmm. and he sort of sees himself as his protector.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, the story is basically how Bartle comes to terms with that responsibility and the repercussions of sort of making that commitment in his own mind to taking on this responsibility.
And there's, you know, in the story and his reflections on, Bartle's reflections on what's happening, you know, he's kind of shored up against these ideas of, you know, realizing that he's ambivalent about a lot of the stuff that's happening, like that his, you know, notion of, you know, his fate there, or what his fate of everyone there is, or what it will be. But he's not ambivalent about Murph. I think he's really committed to him from the beginning and very protective of him. And I thought that was a really interesting cornerstone of their, you know, sort of energy between them.
Mm-hmm.
It's like big brother, little brother, a little bit. But how do you think about their personalities together?
Well, I suppose in a way you could say that Ned Murphy is sort of naive.
Mm.
Not that Bartle comes from a place where he's got all this life experience,
right.
but Murph is from sort of a rural community. You know, he basically grew up in this small town and just has been thrown into this situation. And for the narrator, it's a situation where he's confused about sort of what is his guiding principle. What is he going to sort of, how is he going to kind of set his moral compass?
Right.
And this person that becomes so important to him is sort of a way for him to keep some kind of moral order in his world. I guess the book could say it's about sort of what happens when you try to be good and can't, or when you try to be good and fail.
Right. And the timing of the book as when it opens, that's the period that you were in Iraq.
I was in Iraq 2004 and 2005. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So
when you were there, did you have any inkling of what you'd be doing, you know, when you came home, that you might take these experiences and that they would live on in another way, in fiction or in writing or in some, like, how did you imagine this future for yourself or not?
Well, I can't say that I sort of imagined it exactly the mm-hmm. way that it looks, but I mean, books, literature, mm-hmm. you know, novels, poetry, that's sort of the mechanism by which I've sort of always sort of made sense of the world.
Right.
So while I was writing occasionally while I was there, mm-hmm. not necessarily even directly about my experiences, I mean, I was doing a lot of reading. It was sort of the perfect way for me to get out of that situation.
Right.
And I mean, I think most people who read appreciate that aspect
right.
of the possibility to sort of get out of your own head,
right?
You know,
what did you read when you were there that you really enjoyed? That
actually, I read the first time I read 100 Years of Solitude was mm-hmm. there. I read The Power and the Glory, Graham Greene novel, mm-hmm. which was really amazing. I read Quiet American. God, I read a ton of stuff.
Yeah.
Those are the first couple that come to mind. So my mother was sort of, she'd send me care packages, and usually they'd
nice.
Be full of books. So.
Nice. Well, Graham Greene is an interesting choice for you to be in that setting. I can see why you'd gravitate just towards someone like that.
Yeah, no, well, yeah. I mean, particularly with the Quiet American definitely mm-hmm. resonated with me, but also in The Power and the Glory, you have that sort of, never occurred to me that it may have been on my mind, but sort of the idea that you're trying to be good, but sort of the circumstances are mm-hmm. beyond your control.
And right.
The priest in The Power and the Glory is dealing with that too. So,
and how do you think your novel answers that question that we started with? What's it like over there? Do you think it's a good approximation of, in your sense of having been there? Are
well,
you happy
I,
with the answer?
I mean, I don't know that I even set out to definitively answer that question.
Mm.
I think having been asked that question so many times, I thought it might be good to offer another way of asking it.
Right.
So rather than tell somebody this is what you should think about
right.
the war, I'm saying, well, you've had everybody's had experiences where they've, like as I mentioned earlier,
right.
where they've sort of had difficulty.
Right.
And if you try to just sort of think about that aspect of your own life, I think the opportunity for empathy will present itself. So. I don't know that I'm answering it, but I think it's important to continue to ask the question.
Right. Yeah. And I think that, you know, you did say earlier, you know, the emotions that are playing out in this novel, you know, fear, confusion, anger, you know, those are things that people relate to regardless of the circumstance, and that, you know, you get to explore them and amplify them in an environment where those feelings are more the rule than the exception.
Right.
Right.
Absolutely.
So you came home in 2005,
mm-hmm,
you said?
I did.
And so how long have you been working on the book? Like at what point did you start? Like,
I probably started working, I'm also a poet, so mm-hmm. I was writing a lot of poetry right when I came back, and I realized that I sort of needed a bigger canvas to kind of tell the story that I wanted to tell. So I probably started working on it about 2008. It took
mm-hmm.
me about 4 years to write. So I was, working full time when I started the book and
right.
then finished it down in Texas.
And you're about to finish your MFA there, is
I
that
finished
right?
it. Yeah,
you
finished
did.
In May, yeah.
Hey, congratulations.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Yeah.
You have an MFA right here.
There you go.
Freshly minted.
Yeah.
Brand new book.
That's
like,
right.
You have to be the the model student in your class, right? You didn't have to wait to graduate to get a book contract and everything, right?
I don't know. I'm really pleased with the, yeah, everybody down there was great, so.
Yeah, that's good.
Yeah, that's fantastic.
So what, so you're a lover of literature and writing and a student of it. What made you decide to join the Army? Not that the two things are mutually exclusive,
sure,
but they're very different careers.
They are.
They're very different experiences.
Well, I mean, it's interesting. Growing up, I didn't really know that many people who sort of shared the passion for books and, mm-hmm. and literature. So it didn't really seem like the option is to sort of become a writer or to study literature. It wasn't immediately apparent to me that that was sort of an easy option.
Mm-hmm.
I wanted to go to college, so I knew that if I joined the Army, I'd get college money.
Right.
I don't come from a career military family, mm-hmm. but my father served in the Army, of course my grandparents, my high school sweetheart, and her father was actually in the military too, and
mm-hmm.
he was really important to me.
Right.
So a lot of the role models in my life had served.
Right.
And you know, I mean, I suppose I was idealistic,
mm-hmm.
and I think I still am idealistic.
Mm-hmm.
But it just seemed to make a lot of sense.
Right.
Yeah.
And were you, thinking about the kind of climate that we were in, like what that experience might be like for you versus sort of the historical models you were looking at? I mean, what was your feeling going into that conflict?
Well, I mean, what I focused on was the fact that, in a way, I thought about it as a responsibility to the people that I was with.
Mm-hmm.
They were going. I had sort of made this commitment to go. I wasn't particularly eager.
Right.
I was scared.
Mm-hmm.
I think everybody is scared when they're going into that situation.
Mm-hmm.
But no. I mean, it was an obligation. I had said that I would do it if I had been if I was asked to. So
mm-hmm.
I felt that I needed to fulfill that obligation. So that's sort of the way that I looked at it.
Right.
Okay, I've said that I would do this, and now I have to do it.
Right. It's pretty level too, right? I mean, that is what it when it comes at its simplest definition, right? Service is it is an obligation.
Right.
And,
exactly.
And it is an admirable one that I think that. People in looking at the conflict and the military get very caught up in the issues and not the people. But I think
right.
this novel does a wonderful job of looking at the individuals and what happens to the individuals together as a unit,
mm-hmm.
And what that pressures that they feel,
right.
that obligation being there. And it's beautifully rendered. I don't want to be like overly effusive and gooey, but it really took my breath away a lot reading it because it was just, there's a quality to your prose that is really breathless and beautiful. And so it's just beautifully written.
Thank you.
So I'm really happy for you and excited for this book to come out and for readers to find it and talk about it. It's very moving.
Thank you. I really appreciate that. It's very kind of you.
Thank you for being here today.
Thank you for having me.